So now we're gonna continue with the chapter, that is our session 6, accounting for material and labor cost. In our previous class, we discussed about the material cost little bit, the introduction about the material cost. We discussed about the mechanism. What do we have? The mechanism. How does a material move from one department to the another department? We have three broad departments from which material move. The first one is the raw material, then comes the work in progress, and then it moves to the finished goods. So this is what we discussed. How can we classify the material? Three different ways were there: substance, their makeup, how they are measured, physical properties. And then we discussed that there are three stages of material. Raw material is there, work in progress is there, and the finished goods is there. We discussed about the mechanism, we discussed about the movement of material, and the accounting for material, that what double entries are we going to record. We discussed about that. Requirement, two budgets we discussed. The first one is the purchase budget or raw material usage budget. The second one is the production budget, that how many units you need to produce. And we discussed over here that the closing and the opening stock that we will be taking in the purchases budget, it will be the raw material, whereas in the units produced, it will be the finished goods. Okay, we talked about the movement of goods, like how they are ordered, how they are received, what is the complete procedure, what are the complete documents. We discussed about the ordering of inventory, receiving of inventory, and the complete summary of what proper documentations are required in each of the department and from where they are sent and to where they are sent. Getting it? The new topic that we are going to discuss today is the inventory valuation. How do you value an inventory? Right? So there are three different methods. The first one, as you can see over here, is FIFO method, or first in, first out. Okay? The next one is the weighted average method, FCO method. And the third one is the LIFO method, that is last in, first out. So the basic thing behind each of these methods or the valuation technique is that is the movement of the material. How does the material move? In FIFO method, what we are going to do, first in, first out, it suggests that whatever material that will be coming first will be issued first as well. Okay, whatever material that will be coming first will be issued first. So let's say in the month of January, I have three purchases. So when the material will be issued, the first issue would be made from the first purchase. When it will be finished, then we will be moving on towards the second. When it will be finished, then we will be moving on towards the third one. That is first in, first out. Last in, first out. Last, as the name is suggesting you, that last in, first out means that whatever latest material would be there, that will be issued first. So let's say you have made three purchases again in the month of January. When you will be making the issue of material to the production department, that issue will be from the third purchase. Initially, the first issue will be from the third or the last or the latest purchase. Then if that finishes up, we move on to the second latest, then the third, and then so on. In weighted average, what do? We take an average of the different prices at which we are buying the material. Average. Let's say in the first purchase, you are buying material at $2. In the second purchase, you are buying material at $3. In the fourth purchase, you are buying material at $4. So what we are going to do, after every purchase, we are going to take an average of the price and then issue the units at that particular average price. We are going to mix up all the products, all the raw material, and they will be issued at an average price. We will not be identifying them as this is the first purchase, this is the second purchase in weighted average, because as the name suggests, average, we will be taking the average. So I know it's a bit difficult to understand for you guys through the help of just theory. So definitely we will be discussing one example over here. Consider the following inventory movements. On 1st September, okay, we don't have any opening inventory, right? No opening inventory. 1st September, on 1st of September, we are buying 100 units at a price of £5. Then 2nd September, we are issuing 50 units to production. 10th September, we are buying next 50 units at a price of 5.5. 20th September, we issue 60 units to production. And 27th September, again, we are buying 100 units at a price of 5.6. Okay? So, I'm going to solve the question with you guys over here. The first method that we are discussing is the FIFO method. Now we're going to solve the question. Just tell me the transaction on each of the date. On the 1st of September,
100 units at 5 pounds each.
So we are buying how many units?
100
units at a price of
five.
Okay, so the total price in pounds is
500.
Okay, now what's the next transaction? Issuing, we are issuing the units. Now tell me guys that what is the first slot of inventory that we have? 100 units at a price of
five.
Is there any other slot?
No.
No. So whether it is FIFO, whether it is LIFO, we only have one slot to issue the units. So we are going to use that. Okay. So how many units? So what price shall I select?
Five.
Okay. So 15 to 5? 250. How much is remaining?
250
is remaining. And even the units remaining are 50. Okay. What's the next transaction?
The next transaction. 10th September, buy 50 units at 5.50.
10th September, we are buying at a price of
5.5.
Okay, so
270.
Total them up, 100 units at a total price of
525.
Right. What's the next transaction that we have?
Issue.
At what date?
20th.
Okay, 20th September. How many? 60 units. Okay, tell me now, these total 60 units, now we have two slots. Okay, how many units we have to issue? 60. How many slots do we have before 60?
Two
slots. One is the remaining 50 units at a price of 5, and the second slot is the new units at a price of 5.5. So since we are using FIFO, first in, first out, first of all, what we are going to do? We are going to consume the whole 50 units which are at a price of 5. And then we are going to move towards the next slot of 5.5. So 50 units will be going from
5,
and the remaining 10 units will be going from
5.5.
Getting it? So how am I going to write it? 50 into 5 and 10 into 5.5. So this will be 250 and 55. What's the remaining value? 220 and 40 units are remaining. And the last transaction that we have is
500 units.
Okay, we are now buying how many units? 100 at a price of 5.6. So it will be 560. So 220 plus 560. 780. Okay. This 780. What is this? Closing inventory. Now, whenever you will be having a question on FIFO and LIFO, the examiner will be asking you either the cost of issues. So what is the cost of issue? 250 is the cost of issue. 275. Okay, this is buying, right? Then we have 250 and 55. This is the cost of issue. The closing inventory is 780. So these are the questions that the examiner can ask you from a question by giving a question on inventory valuation. Okay, so in FIFO, whatever the inventory that will be coming first will be issued first. Everyone is clear on this? Okay, now we can just reconcile our answer, the answer, the standard answers that we have over here. What's the value of the closing inventory over here?
780.
Okay, and the first issue is 250, absolutely correct, and the second issue is this one, absolutely correct. So the remaining value was 220. So our answer is absolutely fine, right? Now moving on towards the next one, LIFO method. We are going to use the same data, LIFO method. Right, now in LIFO method, again the first transaction will remain the same. 1st of September, you are buying how many units? 100 at a price of 5. So the total valuation is 500 pounds. Right, the second transaction is on 2nd September, right?
Yes.
Issue. Again, it will remain the same, 50 units at a price of 5, because this is the only slot. So the remaining is 250, and over here remaining units are 50. Right, now what's the third transaction that we have? What's the date?
10
September. Buying 50. 5.5. Okay, so what's the price? Total 275. Right, so 100 units we have, total is 525. Now, what's the next date? 20th September. Issuing. How many units we are issuing? 60. Now guys, this is a point to consider over here. Be focused over here. Now we are issuing 60 units. Which method are we following? LIFO method. Last in, first out. So what is the latest addition? 5.5 or 5? 5.5. So we're going to issue the units at 5.5. Once the slot of 5.5 is finished, then we are going to move towards the 5. So whatever the latest inventory we have, that will be issued first, in last in first out, and then we are going to move on towards the second latest inventory. So over here 50 units will be going from 5.5, and 10 units will be going from 5. So this will become 275 and 50. So what's the remaining value? 40 units?
200.
And in the end, what's the last date?
27th September.
we are buying again 100 at a price of 5.6. So it will be 560, and the value of the closing inventory will be, how many units do we have in closing inventory? 140. And the value of those 140 units is 760 pounds. Everyone is clear?
Yes.
Great. So we'll just reconcile our answer. 760 is the value of inventory. The first one is 250. First 50 units of the second issue is at 5.5. The next is at 5. Right? Okay. Now moving on further, the third method that we have to discuss is the weighted average cost of inventory valuation. So what we're going to have? FCO. Again, the first thing remains the same. 1st of September, we are buying 100 units at a price of £5. So the total we have 500. Then 2nd September, we are issuing 50 units. So that will be going at a price of 5,250. Okay, the third transaction. Can any one of you tell me the third transaction?
Yes, sir. By 50 units.
By?
50 units.
50 units. 5.5. So this will be? 275. 525. 100. Now, guys, please be focused over here and carefully listen to this. The first step is exactly the same, because we don't have any two things so that we can take the average of that. The first issue will definitely be at a price of 5. 5. Okay? 5. The first issue. Right? After that, how many units are remaining? 50 units. 50 units are remaining at a price of 5. And we bought some new units at a price of 5.5. So the total cost of now 100 units is 525. So what will you do? You will divide the total cost with the total units to get the average price. Now do that. Quickly do that. 5.25. So this is your average price. Now, the next transaction is 20th September, and we are issuing the inventory. How many units we are issuing? 60 units we are issuing. So simply 60 into 5.25. Calculate the value. 315. Subtract that. Okay. 210. And the last transaction is 27th September, buying 100 units at a price of 5.6. So that will be 560. How much? 770. Calculate the average price again. 770. 770 divided by 140. 5.5. So the new average price will be 5.5. So what did we learn in the weighted average method? That after every purchase or after every buying in material, you will be calculating an average price. Everyone is clear? Great. So we'll just reconcile our answer over here. 770 is the correct answer, and the last weighted average price is 5.5, and this is 770. Okay, clear? Great. Now tell me, guys, one thing. We need to discuss few things. Let's suppose in general, normally inflation is there, right? Normally inflation is there and prices are increasing because of inflation. If you go 10 years back and compare the price of, let's say, rice. So 1 kg of rice that you were getting, let's suppose, in $5, just giving an example, maybe it's $10 now. Why? Because of inflation. Because of inflation, the prices are increasing slowly and gradually. Now tell me one thing. You have a situation in which prices are rising. Okay? Prices are increasing. Rising, increasing. And you are using FIFO method. So these cost of issue goes into your cost of sales as a production cost, because the material that we are using is issued to production department, so it goes to the production cost of the company. So when prices are rising, it means the latest material will be at a higher price and the previous material will be at a lower price. Everyone clear up till here?
Yes.
Fine. When the latest material is at a higher price and the previous material is at a lower price, if you are using FIFO, which one will you issue? The first one. The first one. The price is lower or higher for that?
Lower.
The price is lower. When the price is lower, the production cost will be lower or higher?
Lower.
Because you will be issuing lower cost material first. So when the cost of that material is lower, so definitely your production cost will be
lower.
When your production cost will be lower, your profit will be higher or lower?
Higher.
Profit will be higher. Getting it? So you are issuing the material at cheaper price. Let's say I'm giving you example. You made purchases in 3 different months of the year: January, June and December. In January, the purchases that you made was at $5. In June, the purchases that you made was at $6. And in December, the purchases that you made was for $7. Now, in the next year, let's say the material from each of the slot is present with you. 5, 6, 7. Every material is present. In the next year, when you will be issuing the units, issuing the raw material to the production department, if you are using FIFO, which one will you issue first? 5, 6 or 7?
5.
You will be issuing at a price of 5. That 5 will be going to your cost of sales or production cost. When your cost of sales is at 5, so it is lower or higher? It is lower. When your cost is lower, your profit will be higher. On the other side, same scenario. On the other side, if you are using LIFO, in the next year, every 3 material is with you. $5 material is with you, $6 material is with you, and $7 material is with you. If you are using LIFO, which one will you issue first?
Seven.
The latest one, which is at a price of
seven.
So when you are issuing, so it has the highest price. Right? It has the highest price. So your production cost also will be higher and profit will be lower. Getting it? So the point that we made over here is this: in times of rising prices, in times of rising prices means that in a situation when your prices are rising, if you will be using FIFO, your production cost will be lower, profit will be higher. Okay, if you are using LIFO, your production cost will be higher, profit will be lower. What about weighted average? What about weighted average? So we can say that we are taking average of the higher and the lower.
Yes.
So the profit will be higher than LIFO but lower than FIFO because it will be in between them. Same is the case with the cost. Cost will be higher than FIFO because FIFO has the lowest cost. Higher than FIFO, lower than LIFO. Okay, weighted average will be in between FIFO and LIFO. FIFO has highest profit, lowest cost. LIFO has highest cost, lowest profit. And in weighted average, we will be in between both of the extreme scenario. Getting my point? Let's just go through this slide now. In FIFO, each issue of stock is valued at a price paid for the material first taken into stock from which the issue could have been drawn. It means that in FIFO we will be taking the issue cost, that is first, the initial purchase. In LIFO, each issue is valued at a price paid for the material taken last into the stock from which issue could have been drawn. It means the last one will be issued first. Weighted average, the weighted average cost is calculated each time prior to the issue of the material. Prior means before. So before issuing, if you look at this example, before issuing every time we were taking an average cost. Okay, can you guys look, this is the issue and this is the average cost. So before every issue we were making or we were taking an average cost. So this is what we are gonna do. To calculate the cost of issue, the total value of the stock to date, it means the total stock that is with you, let's say 100 units, and the value of that total stock is 600, so the average price will be 6. Okay, is divided by the number of units to the date. Everyone is clear?
Yes.
On this thing, FIFO, LIFO, no problem at all? Great. Now we have already discussed about the accounting of material, that how the double entries takes place. Material purchase are recorded as debit in the material control account and credit will be either cash or payables, right? Direct material, when the material is issued to the direct material, where it is going? To the work in progress. So work in progress debit, raw material credit. Indirect material. Indirect material is part of what? Prime cost or overheads? Overheads. So instead of work in progress, what will be debited? Overheads will be debited. And which overheads? Production or non-production?
Production
overheads. Production overheads will be debited because now it is not going into the direct work in progress. It is going to the overheads. So production overheads debit, again raw material credit. Everyone is clear? Okay, labor cost. This sums up our material cost over here. So the main thing, what's the main thing in material cost? FIFO, LIFO and FCO. Okay, the inventory valuation techniques, you need to have a good grip on them. Labor cost, if you remember, in material, as we discussed at the start of the lecture, we can divide the material onto three types: the substance they make up, the physical properties, how they can be measured. Three different classification we can have. Same is the case with the labor. Labor can also be divided by the three different types. How? Some prior agreement, let's say managers, the directors, they have fixed salary because they have it in their agreement. So managers and supervisors usually have fixed salary. They are not given on the monthly basis like a labor. amount of time worked normally, the best example is labors. Labors are given amount based on the hourly basis, that if you will work for 10 hours, you will get per hour $100. If you will work 9 hours, 90. If you will work 8, 80. So that depends. The rate is fixed, but the rate is again, the total value of the labor cost will be dependent on the amount of time worked. Quantity and the quality of work done. Over here, what we are going to talk about? We are going to talk about the productivity of the labor. The labor was supposed to produce the goods, let's say in 10 hours. They were supposed to produce 50 units in 10 hours. But they produced 50 units in, let's say, 8 hours. So they have saved 2 hours. It means their efficiency is good, their productivity is good. So for that 2 hours, company will give them some bonus. Productivity bonus or the time saved bonus. Right? So this is how we calculate the labor. Labor is not into much more detail. We have very basic calculation for labor over here. So we're going to talk about each one of them. But before going into the detail of that, I'll just explain you about the payroll accounting system. How does the payroll works? Payroll basically is the area of an organization where all the details related to employees are present. The names, their addresses, their personal details, their educational background, qualifications, what's the terms and conditions with the employees, what are the contracts with the employees, how much pay they will be given, what are their medical insurances and all the benefits that you're going to get. Everything is decided in payroll department. So payroll has employee codes and employee numbers, the classification of the employees, who is the high level employees, middle level employees, low level employees, and then the labors, everything in the payroll. What will be the range of salary for this particular level, range of salary for the next level, range of salary for the top level, everything is in the payroll. So what does payroll usually do is, they calculate the amount of being to be paid to the employee. So how can they do that? The first one is the attendance record or a clock card. Attendance record, like we have over here for your attendance, that which student is attending the class and which student is not attending the class, right? Similarly, in the organization, we have the attendance record for the employees. If they are coming to the organization, they will be marked as present. What time are they coming? Are they coming late? Are they coming on time? Are they coming before time? Everything would be there in the attendance record. Clock card, you guys might have seen that there are, like, now in the organization, instead of just manually marking the attendance, they have swipe cards. So when you swipe the card, the gate opens and your attendance is automatically marked according to the computerized systems. So it is the advanced version of the attendance record. Job time will also be recorded on things like daily time sheets, that daily how many hours you are working, weekly time sheets, in a week how many hours you are working. Standard working hours are 48 hours in a week. You are working 50 hours, give him 2 hours overtime amount. Getting it? Job cards. Job cards are basically the cards kind of like record the attendance, but specific to a job, that how much time employee is spending on this particular job. Getting it? So let's say the job of a company is to build, let's say, buildings. So there are 3 different projects are going on, and an employee is working on all of the 3 different projects. So he will be looking at, okay, on project A, I work for 2 hours. On project B, I work for 3 hours. On project C, I work for 2.5 hours. So job cards will be telling you that. Getting it? Piece work ticket or operation card. Sometimes employees are also given payments on the basis of number of units they produce. That is known as the piece work payment. That if you produce, if you give the amount on based on the number of units that the company is producing, known as the piecework system, piecework payment, that on every unit that you will be producing, you will be getting this much amount. So if let's say on each unit we have $2, so if you will be producing 100 units, $200. So the payment will be based on number of units instead of number of hours. Okay, and route cards are more or less the same thing as the job cards. Okay, incentive schemes. How does a company design the incentives for the company, for the employees? So definitely the first thing is the salary that they get. That is an incentive for the exchange of services that the employee is providing to the organization. So let's say, because as an employee, are you manufacturing the goods and selling it to the company? Are you doing that? No, you are providing services, and in exchange of that services, you require what? Some monetary payment, right? Some monetary payment is being required in exchange for the services that you are providing to the organization. So we have different incentive scheme, different payment schemes. The first one is the constant weekly or monthly amount. Okay, just a second. Right, the next one that we have is the piecework. As I've been explaining it to you, piecework based on the number of units you produce. Now there can be a simple piecework, like every unit that you are producing, you'll get the same amount for that, $2. And there can be differential piecework as well, that for units from 1 to 100, you will get 2. From 100 to 150, you will get 2.5. And from 150 onwards, you will get 3. So that is known as the differential piecework. So we have two kind of piecework, and that is the simple piecework and differential. Right, then we have time save bonus. As I gave you the example that the employee is saving the time on the production, he will be getting bonus for that. Discretionary bonus. The word discretion means on the choice of the directors. If they are happy with your performance, they can give you one-off bonus. Yes, give that person a bonus, or give this team of employees a bonus. Discretion, it is their choice. If they want to give it, they can give it. If they don't want to give it, they will not give it. That is on the choice of the management of the company. Group bonus, if you're working as a team, you work as a team, okay, fine. This is our team. You had a project, you achieved that project within the given time period, within the given cost, and at the specified agreement. So company is happy, okay, fine, this team has delivered us what they promised to us. So they might give you some group bonus. But you know what, in group bonus, there's a conflict. Can any one of you think of that? In a group bonus, what?
The amount will be divided into persons equally.
Yeah, exactly. The amount would be divided in the team members equally. So there might be an argument between them that I have worked more, you have worked less. Even then we are getting the same amount. So that can be a conflict of interest between the group bonus. So that is why company usually prefer giving individual bonuses rather than the group bonus. But definitely group bonus do exist. Profit sharing, rather than giving them a bonus, or you can just base your bonus on the amount of profit being achieved by the company. So let's say the company is achieving 1 million as a profit. So they are saying that 1% is the bonus for the employees, 2% is the bonus for the employees. So they are basing their bonus on the profit being achieved by the company. Okay, so we'll have few examples now. The first one is the piecework example. Calculate the labor cost for an employee. This is an example of differential piecework. Calculate the labor cost for an employee who has produced 85 units in a week. So the slots that have been given to us are from 0 to 50 it is $4 per unit, 51 to 70 it is 5 per unit, and from 70 above the pay rate is 5.5 per unit. Now here we don't have any of the search requirements such as rejected units or things like that, but just give me an answer. Let's suppose I'm producing 100 units. I'm producing 100 units of which 10 are rejected. What will you do? You will calculate 90. You will calculate on 90 or 100? 90. But you produce the other 10 as well. No, it's not a kind of a fine, you can say, but you're right, your answer is correct, that we're gonna pay them only for the 90 units. Because what's the contract between the employee or the labor and the company? You provide us good units, completed units. What is required by the company? That was the 90 units, not the extra 10 units which were rejected. If the units are rejected, so definitely they are of no use to the company. Company will only pay to the employee for the 100% good units, okay, not for the rejected ones. Here you don't have any such requirement, but I'm just giving you an idea, because usually you have these kind of questions in the exam in which you have the rejected units as well. Okay, so start solving this question. 85 units we have, slots are given to you, start solving. It's just a simple use of common sense.
4, 4, 4, 6, 7, 1.
Okay, I'll just solve this one with you guys. How many units we are producing total? 85 units in total. The first 50, from 1 to 50 units, the first 50 are at a price of 4, right? So this will be 200. The next 20, from 51 to 70, is at a price of 5. So this will be 100. And the next 15, from 71 to 85, 15 units will be at a price of 5.5. So that is 82.5. So the total will be 382.5 pounds or dollars. Okay, easy to understand? Okay, now moving on further, the next thing that we have to discuss is the time saved bonus. So obviously we have gone into the theoretical part of that. We'll just solve the question on this to have a better understanding of that. Guys, I want your focus over here. Illustration. Basic pay is 9 per hour. Basic means normal pay. If you work for the normal hour of the company, 9 per hour for a 40 hour week. The normal or the standard hours for 1 week is 40. Great. How many units are expected or the standard to be produced in that 1 week? 120 units. Bonus is 50% of the time saved on the production paid at a time and a third. So I'll explain it to you. Okay, I'll explain it to you. What will be the total wage in a week in which 150 units are made in 40 hours? What was the standard time to work in 1 week?
40 hours.
40 hours. So they are working for 40 hours. How many units were expected to be produced?
120
units. How many they are producing?
150.
It means they have saved some time, because of which instead of producing 120, they are producing 150. Okay, now the first thing is to calculate the basic pay. How many hours they are working?
90.
40.
Yeah, 40.
And what's the rate per hour? 9. So 40 into 9, 360. The first thing that we have over here is 360. Okay, the next thing that you can see is they are saying that 150 units should take 50 hours. How do we get that? Just look over here. How many hours are there? The standard hours are 40. And in those standard hours, how many units we are producing? 120. Divide 40 by 120 and tell me how many hours is being taken by one unit standard time. Okay. Yeah, I'm just that is what I'm explaining you. Right? One unit is taking 0.33 hours. One unit is taking how many hours? 0.33, or you can say 20 minutes, because there are 60 minutes in an hour. So 20 minutes are being taken by one unit, or 0.33 hours are being taken by one unit. Multiply this 0.33 by 150. 50 hours. It means according to the standard time, according to the standard time. So what we are going to do? 150 into 0.33. So this gave us total 50 hours. It means that according to the standard time, 150 units should have taken 50 hours. In how many hours we are producing? 40 hours. So what is the time saved? 10 hours. So whenever you are doing a question on time saved, first of all, what to do? Calculate the basic pay. Simple. Calculate the basic pay, right? After that, what you need to do is to calculate the time saved and apply the application of bonus. Over here, what they are saying? 50% of the time saved. So how are we going to calculate the bonus? 50% of the time saved on production paid at a time and a third. So they are giving you ratio that at what rate you will be paying them. At what rate you will be paying them. So what is our basic rate?
Nine.
Right? Our basic rate is nine. And the time that we are saving, what is the rate for that? Time and a third. It means basic rate plus a premium of third part of that. What is the third part of 9? 3. If you divide 9 into 3 areas or divide it by 3, so what you will get?
3.
So the ratio that we will have over here is 1 by 3. Right? So what will be the rate? Basic rate is 9. Premium is 3. So the total rate will be 12. Okay? Basic rate is 9. Premium is 12. Because you are saving some time, because of which they are giving you some premium. So that will be premium for you. So 50% of the time saved. How many hours we are saved?
10.
What is the 50% of that?
5.
5 12 is a 60. So the total earning or the total pay for the employee will be 420.
Sir, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Sir, over here they have calculated the bonus by 15, 10 into 9 into 1 by 15.
Yeah.
Sir, divided by 12.
It's there is no any specific method for the bonus. Whenever they tell you about the time saved, what you have to do, you just have to go through with the flow of the question, because in every question they will be giving you a different technique to calculate the bonus according to the question. Over here they are saying 50%, go on the wording, what they are saying, 50% of the time saved. So we said, okay, 50% multiply by the time saved. Time saved is 10. Paid on production paid at a time and a third. So what is our basic rate? 9. So we add a premium on that, 3, 12. So 5 into 12. Getting it?
Yes.
Okay. Now we have one very small concept to discuss over here, and that is the gross pay, net pay, and total cost to employer. Right? Gross pay. Gross pay means whatever you are earning from the company. You guys know that there is one scheme known as PAYE. P-A-Y-E. PAYE. If you elaborate it, it's termed as pay as you earn. Okay? It's elaborated as pay as you earn. PAYE. According to this scheme, let's suppose you are working in UK, right? You're working in UK, whatever your salary will be, or even any part of the country, in European countries or even in the non-European countries, whatever you earn, your salary will be deducted by the amount of tax. Tax, insurance, and any contribution into the pension plan. Right? So the salary that you are earning, the total salary is your gross pay, gross amount, total amount. The net pay is the amount which you are getting after all the deduction, deduction of tax, deduction of contribution. Okay, we have to, in pension plan, there's a pension plan, employee contributes some amount, employer also contributes some amount. Okay. When we will be calculating the net pay, what, which one will be relevant for us? Employee contribution or employer contribution? Employee contribution, because only employee will be responsible for his contribution. Employer will be making contribution on his part. That will not be deducted from our salary. If it would have been deducted from our salary, so what's the point of calling it employer contribution? Getting it? So gross pay. Gross pay is the total amount that you earn. The basic pay, the overtime, the bonus, everything included is your gross pay. From that gross pay, tax is deducted. Insurance is deducted.
So this doesn't happen in the business, right? Apart from the pension plan.
Yeah. Yeah. Because over here, most of the countries are tax-free. Right? So there's no tax. So in, if you talk about the European countries, right? In European countries, let's say income tax. Whatever income you are having, you have to pay some tax on that. Right? Different kinds of taxes are there. VAT is one of the tax, value added tax. Right? Different tax we have. So what you need to do, you have to remove the effect of tax, insurance, and the contribution. Coming back to the third one, that is total labor cost. Total labor cost. If the company is paying you some salary, whose cost it is? Company's cost, because they are paying you. So whatever they are paying you plus the contribution, okay? Whatever they are paying you plus the employer's contribution into the pension plan, because employer will also be contributing in your pension. So the total pay or the gross pay that the company is paying you plus the contribution that employer is making in your pension plan.
That is gross pay, not net pay.
That is the total labor cost to employer.
That is gross pay plus employer.
Gross pay plus the employer's contribution. Okay, so we'll just go through it. Gross pay, the total amount earned by the employee. Everything, overtime, bonus, right? Okay, this over here, I want to tell you something. Whenever we calculate the cost of labor, whenever we calculate the cost of labor, we have one thing called overtime. Yeah? When you work more than the standard hours, the extra hours that you are working for is known as the
overtime.
So obviously, why will you work for overtime? Because your rate that you will be getting will be higher than the basic rate. Getting it? So overtime rate is made up of two things. Overtime rate is made up of two things. That is basic rate plus overtime premium. Right? Two things are there. Let's suppose your basic rate is 10 and the employer is telling you, that if you work overtime, you will be getting a rate of time and a half. So what will be your overtime rate?
15.
Time and a half, your basic rate is 10 and they are giving you option for time and a half. So time and a half means 15. So out of that 15, 10 is your basic, 5 is your premium. So whatever the basic that you have will be your direct cost for direct labors. And premium, overtime premium is always indirect cost or overhead. Okay? Right. So we were talking about the net pay, the amount paid to the employee after the employer make deduction for income tax and any certain statutory amounts. Statutory means required by law. Total labor cost to the employer, employee's gross pay plus any additional taxes that the employer has to bear. Okay?
Sir, just one question.
Yeah. Yeah.
Income, when we have done overtime,
yeah.
Does the overtime count while
lifting
the tax?
Or because your tax is applied on your total income. So whatever income you have, whether it is bonus, whether it is overtime, whether it's basic pay, everything will be included and then tax will be applied on that. Okay. Now we need to identify, this is the last thing in the chapter, what cost regarding labor will be direct cost, what cost regarding labor will be indirect cost. Now I need to make one point very clear, every cost regarding indirect labor will be indirect. Indirect labor completely indirect cost. Indirect labor completely indirect cost. What cost do we consider as direct labor? The one which is involved in the production. The one which is involved in the production. Now, the cost of direct labor will be considered as direct cost, but some costs will be considered as direct and some will be indirect. So definitely the basic pay that we are paying them, for what we are paying them the basic pay? For production. So that will be considered as direct cost. Okay. If overtime is at a specific request of a customer, does it click in your mind that when I told you about direct and indirect, whenever you hear these kind of words, specific, special, particular, it turns into a direct cost. It turns into a direct cost. Special tools, special expenditure. Whatever the term special or specific you have, it turns into a direct cost. Okay, at that time, that overtime will be considered as? Now, guys, please keep in mind, in the overtime of the labor, there is one basic amount and the overtime premium. Basic will always be direct. In normal situation, I'm not talking about the specific request of a customer. In a specific request, total overtime will become direct. But in normal situation, the examiner is not saying anything. In normal situation, overtime, basic part of overtime will be direct and premium part will be indirect. Okay? So basic will be direct and premium will be indirect. And overtime work regularly by the production department. So that is what I am telling you, the basic part of the overtime. Though now Indirect cost, obviously every cost related to indirect labor. Overtime premium, indirect. Bonuses, indirect. Employees, national insurance contribution, indirect. Idle time, indirect. Sick pay, indirect. Holiday pay, indirect. Leave pay, indirect. Every cost is indirect which is not involved in the production. Getting it? So what costs are involved in the production? The basic pay and the overtime. And what part of overtime? Only the basic part of the overtime or any specific request of the customer. Clear, guys? So that is it from the chapter. Now we will be moving on towards the questions of that. Just take a break and then we will be coming back for the questions. Thank you very much, guys.